Hello and welcome back for the last game of the day. It's CLG versus FlyQuest, and we've got banger after banger. This one's a big one as well. FlyQuest technically still in reach of a playoff bye. They need to go 2-0, and they hope that TL beats TSM and CLG beats Cloud9. In that case, take a tiebreak for it. Sounds good. That's the hope. Now, of course, there's a lot going on here as well. On the CLG side, they're going to hope they can hold on to playoffs right now. They're tied with Dignitas.
Yeah, I mean, they started out so strong, you know, at the beginning of the split, but really they have struggled constantly since then. They are, you know, sitting at 1-6 in the second half, you know, worse than the league during that stretch. So they really need to pick up some wins, especially because Dignitas did just grab a win. They only need one win to clinch playoffs.
Yep.
But they have some tough opponents. So, you know, there's a high chance, honestly, of them going 0-2 against FlyQuest and C9, who are both heavily favored over Cloud9, especially given their current level performance.
Sure, and that's going to be the tough one here. So CLG trying to shake things up and shape up for the back end of the split means we have new players coming in. Fragus and Tuesday are coming in, as we'd expect, for FlyQuest to 2-0. But still, CLG looking at bringing in some Academy talent to make things happen. Replacing the jungler with Fragus, I think, is actually a very defensible option. Replacing Pumulter with Tuesday is, to me, more questionable.
Yeah, we were taking a look at, you know, a lot of the stats for these players. You know, Tuesday, you know, ranks as one of, if not the worst laner in Academy among mid laners. So how he will stand up to Power of Evil, that is a really big question for me. And then also he'll have to go up against Niski if he stays in the lineup. So, you know, you're putting perhaps the weakest laner in Academy up against two of the best in DLCS, and you expect that to be a bit of a recipe for a disaster. But that being said, you know, he does have the inbuilt synergy and practice with Fragus. Jungle mid is incredibly important there, so maybe they are just looking more to maintain that until that is more important. It also has to be said, despite the fact that Pobelter has been performing pretty well overall in the LCS individually, they're not winning with him. So I respect taking the shot at a bit of a Hail Mary here. Say, hey, we're expecting to lose FlyQuest and C9 anyway. Let's change something up. Let's see if we can inject a little excitement into the roster. You know, I'm sure they're down in the dumps a bit. So you bring in some Academy players. You bring in some new energy. You see if you can mix something up, grab a win, and secure playoffs.
And I will say, if my recollection is proper, that since Immortals have lost, the worst CLG can do is a tiebreaker at 5-13 across the board. I believe they're 1-1 against both those teams regardless, so it shouldn't be anything but that if those wins come through. So obviously, you win here today, or you win tomorrow, or you win your tiebreaker, and CLG make it into playoffs. And they're saying, look, let's make sure that we have the right roster to go. But the best I can tell, their fate is in their own hands for CLG, and they're going to hope they can shake it up here against FlyQuest. FlyQuest will see what happens, of course. They can get second, they can get third. We'll see what goes on for them. It's going to be the early set pickup, a very high prize here in pro play, and Ashe going to be answered as Caitlyn was banned away.
Something I'm really excited about and kind of praying for, honestly, is that Fragus brings out his Vi, because it's actually been, you know, really good for him in Academy. He has played it quite a lot. You know, he has 4 plays, 75% win rate. It has been his best performing champion. So that would be really exciting to see that come into the LCS with the set being picked up. It doesn't fully eliminate the chance of that, as this obviously could be still top lane or mid lane. We have been seeing a lot of those types of things. I also think it would make sense to bring a different look, right? Because no one is playing Vi in the LCS. So if you're trying to go for this Hail Mary, if you're trying to go for the upset, play something that people are less used to, are less comfortable against, and Vi could be that ticket to an upset win.
Yeah, I think if you do anything, it's you pick the set, you grab the flex going, and the set is now less flexible. It's right now only mid-top jungle, and I haven't seen Ruin play set all split long, nor have we really seen Tuesday pick that one up. So there's a chance it just simply goes to Fragus as his second most played of the split. Regardless, we'll see what comes down as PUE gets to lock in the final pick for FlyQuest before the second round of bans. And the one problem I do have with grabbing an early Vi is that you simply play something like a Tahm Kench or even a Morgana, and the ult gets real useless real fast. And the counterplay is a little bit easy. There's a little bit of counterpicking required for that champ, but still, I agree, I would love to see it.
Yeah, I have no problem with the order or anything like that.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think that they need to first pick it or it's going to get taken away or whatever.
Yeah,
but
I know.
You know, honestly, if I was FlyQuest, I would be just banning Vi 100%. Because when you look at across the champion pools, the only thing that actually stands out as something that you wouldn't have played against a thousand times in scrims this year is the Vi, right? So, you know, if I'm FlyQuest, eliminate that variable, take away the Vi, deny that opportunity for them to kind of mix things up. But I think more than likely, it probably is just set going to Fragus anyway, and we're not going to get that excitement of the Vi pick, because as you said, Ruin hasn't played it, Tuesday hasn't played it in Academy, so it's possible that the set could be flexed, but I'm expecting it to go to the jungle for now. They are looking towards this Bard Ezreal lane. You know, not one of the strongest laning duos, especially when you're up against the Ashe. You know, there is the ability for things to be a bit rough down there. The ban of the Rakan is very much aimed towards Ignar, who it's his most played by far. He has been very effective at finding different angles and flanks with this. But they can still go towards an Enchanter support and probably just slam this lane. And 6A and Smoothie have been, you know, one of the weakest laners, laning duos in the LCS. So I think that's something that FlyQuest could look to exploit.
Well, CLG, weak laners across the board, really. And looking over at what Fragus and Tuesday have been doing in Academy, they're down gold frequently. And it's not like CLG Academy is a bad team. They are fifth place at, I think they ended up 9-9, but they were 8-8 with this roster, like, or, you know, with Fragus and Tuesday in that roster. Like, they were an acceptable Academy team, but they still had weak early games even in Academy. We're going to see the rest of the picks come through. Rumble, by the way, a flex pick between Ruin and Tuesday, so that is doing a little bit of double duty. It does mean that Syndra is up as a possibility, although when Tuesday played it, it was a 0.2 KDA, so, you know, play it if you really want, even though it's supposed to be a good matchup, might not look the best. I'm excited to see Pyke in, though. Ignar is an exciting player, he's a good engaged player, he's always dealing the damage, and I love seeing Pyke.
Pyke is really, really fun to watch. This is not really for that laning duo, I don't think. You know, maybe post 6 you can set something up to try to get a kill there. The blind Kennen feels like that could be very punishable here, you know, by solo. We have seen Kennen largely be fairly ineffective throughout the LCS. Solo is someone who does feel very comfortable going to a lot of the tanks. He did even bring out the Maokai. I think that is an option that could be you know, very strong for FlyQuest. You can obviously go for some of the range matchups and actually just go right at the Kennen too.
Yep.
But it's going to be double AP solo laners. And it does feel like overall CLG's composition is fairly magic damage heavy, because you're expecting, you know, set to be tank. And then you have the double AP solo laners and Ezreal with some mixed damage Bard, pretty much all magic damage.
Alrighty, well, the roster has been locked in. Nothing surprising here. The Vi, sadly, not going to be on the table. It is set jungle as somewhat expected. The Kennen in the top side will be answered by Mordekaiser, which I like a lot in any given team fight. One of the ways you can lose is a big Kennen flank that stuns your whole team, and solo goes, nah, dog, you're in the death realm with me. I'm the only one getting stunned. My team's going to win the 4v4. I really, really do like the Mordekaiser, not just as a duelist, but as a team fighter to deny team fight aggression. I think it's such a cool, underrated aspect of the pick, and solo with some good play and pressing R and clicking on the opposing champion can really do good wonders in team fights.
It is interesting, because I also think that you can kind of do the same thing with a Maokai or whatever, but anyway, we'll see how
sure.
It goes. I don't think that, you know, this is a matchup that should be that bad for solo, but I do expect Kennen to have the run of the lane at least early on, as long as you're actually, you know, dodging out a lot of those skill shots from the ward, you know, the grasp in particular. I do think Kennen can have a pretty good time, but overall, you know, CLG, I think, is going to have to show something pretty special, because, you know, they are heavy underdogs here. You know, there's good scaling over on the other side, and I think FlyQuest have positioned themselves well to kind of play their style. This is Power of Evil in his comfort zone, playing a scaling mage. There is frontline, there is engage. You know, there's really everything that FlyQuest would need to play, you know, a very comfortable macro style game, and it's going to be up to CLG, I think, to disrupt that.
Yeah, and that's going to be fun to watch for, right? Is CLG have 2 and realistically 3 games left to play in the regular season. They're going to fight FlyQuest. They're going to fight Cloud9. I'm expecting them to lose both, and that means they are almost certainly destined for a tiebreaker with Dignitas and maybe Immortals. And they've got to figure out by that point in time what the best starting 5 is, what, you know, the strategies need to be, what the picks need to be, so that they can get that last spot in playoffs, because there's only one spot left up for grabs. And right now, Dig and CLG have 5 wins fighting for it. And they're going to battle later on, you know, to do it most likely. On the FlyQuest side, I think we're selling them ever so slightly short. And the thing is, we're already saying they're a very good team, but looking at the schedule, I actually expect them to take TSM's spot at third, because TSM fights Team Liquid, and Team Liquid's beating everybody right now, and FlyQuest owned the head-to-head 2-0. There is a very real shot FlyQuest goes up to, you know, 12-6 and takes third seed automatically and says, okay, here we go, we're going to go fight EG down in sixth and close this one out. Like, that seems like the possibility. I'm curious what that looks like. Regardless, I do want to see how good FlyQuest look. We know they're upper bracket. We know there is a very slim chance to get the playoff bye. And I just want to see them tuned up and ready to go as a playoff threat.
They've also beat some really good teams lately. They beat Golden Guardians, who has actually been doing very well in the second half, albeit didn't have a great weekend this weekend. They beat TL, they beat TSM. You know, they have taken down some very strong opponents. They did lose to C9, but that's their only loss in the last six games, and they are, so they've won five of their last six. They're on a four-game winning streak. They are shaping up, right in the nick of time. Santorin, I think rightfully so, has been getting a lot of credit. He has been really intelligent about how he's actually playing out these games, how he's pathing. He's able to find, a lot of really unique gank paths and angles at timings that players are not expecting. That is kind of really throwing them off. So we'll see how Fragus can deal with that. Tuesday going to have the triple barred health pack there from Smoothie. So Tuesday going to have the advantage of not only that full crafting potion, but essentially an extra health potion and a half or so of healing. It's about 225 with that level one. Depends a bit based on the stat shards you take and stuff, but it's quite a lot extra of health for that 1v1, so we'll see how he holds up here against Power of Evil.
Going to be a Krug skip here for the set start. Not a big shock right there. Trundle going single target camps, as you do with Machete Trundle. Red to blue to Gromp to, doing something else around the map. Maybe a backwards clear through Wolves or whatever else. Right now, bot pressure is with FlyQuest. It's unexpected, but the fact that Smoothie doesn't have a spell right now, he put the packs down in mid, you can only ever have three. So until Tuesday eats them, you literally shouldn't press W, because then why'd you put them down in the first place? So they're going to play the backside. That's okay. FlyQuest pushing down. Tuesday, obviously feeling very comfortable to take this very early aggression. If it takes damage, whatever, grab a health pack.
Mm-hmm. Yep. You want to try to trade, right? And, you have a ton of sustain. So any sort of like even trade you can take is honestly a winning trade. And that's kind of how you get the most use out of those health packs. And also, to your point, you can't actually place them until they have started to be taken down in that bot lane. So taking those trades and starting to get use out of them now allows Smoothie to start placing them down in that bot lane and having them for the 2v2 also.
So what you're saying, Azale, is there are some very severe tariffs on that trade. And, all the money's going one way. So Tuesday, off to an early good start right there. Ruin pushing in solo. I don't imagine the 1v1 looks that good. I feel like Kennen has a pretty easy time dodging the backwards claw. The attack range and Q line up pretty well. You can auto then back, just back up and not get pulled either. So far, so good. But again, I don't feel like this is a super grab for the 1v1. Maybe it really flips at two items and it's just like completely doomed for Ruin once you get there. And that's actually the possibility. But again, I still like what it looks like in team fights and wait to get there.
Yep. I do think that, he should be fine. You shouldn't get absolutely blown out, especially if you're worried about that. As solo, you can go fairly defensive runes. He obviously is starting the Doran shield. And you can't go into resolve secondary, and he actually has. So he's gone second wind. So that is really the, I don't want to lose versus range setup. Doran shield plus second wind is more than enough, usually, to keep you pretty healthy. So unless he gets dove or something, I don't expect this to get out of control. But Fragus is pathing up here. With solo still at full health, I don't think they can even look for it, though, and solo should just be able to be at a pressure disadvantage, but stay evenish in farm and go from there.
Well, a room up to the middle lane. Tuesday is going to get pulled right back in. It's a burn the flash. Thankfully has some health runes, but he's still going to get pillared up. Won't turn into a kill, but Tuesday is now out of his flash, and that is a nice roam in the mid lane.
Mm-hmm. Ignite down, but they do get that flash. Unfortunately, Santorin got hit by that same stun as Ignar, because if he could have actually pillared in Tuesday immediately after the flash, I think that is a kill. So credit to Tuesday for a really well-placed knockback there, and solo landing a couple of pulls does mean Ruin is getting the worst end of some of these trades, but he does have the minion dematerializer, so that is going to likely give him a pretty free push. And it's really just all about actually dodging the claw when you're playing against Mordekaiser, because if you hit the claw, the Q is guaranteed. The timing is such that the claw pulls you in and the Q is buffered and it will always land on you, so you really have to avoid that one skill more than anything else.
Looking at a player on the bottom side, Wild Turtle right now not quite in stun, and the Q, nice try. Smoothie tried to feather it through, land that on one caster, find someone behind. Turtle though positioned well enough to not be tagged. End of the day, it's going to be pretty easy for him. One caster under danger, the rest going to be not too hard. Easy.
Look at Fragus's build. So this is actually a Swifties rush. Very atypical. You almost always will see the Chilling Smite into Bombie. So this is very aggressive. To me, this is like you have to get something done. because your clear is going to be much worse when you're actually having a very delayed center hold. Your overall team fighting is going to be a lot weaker. It's kind of somewhat similar. I mean, it's not a one-to-one comparison, but when we used to have a lot of Elise and there was like the Mobi's Rush Elise type games where it's like you're investing into move speed so you can be everywhere, so you can be more effective on the ganks and really get something done. And to me, if Fragas can't make anything happen, this 50 paid off.
Couple of punches. Can he output the blast cone? That's not too bad. Ignar can't get all the way over the wall, but he's still invisible. Dodges the stun. Good play there. That could have been a setup with a flash to pull in Santorin. That's going to be a summoner used. That is a smite and a runaway. No problem there. Santorin doesn't have to burn the flash, but Fragas did.
Mm-hmm. So Fragas finding a little bit of a scuffle there. They do get the flash off of Ignar too, so it is a bit of a trade overall. I would say, you know, if you're FlyQuest, you're pretty happy with that. You know, getting that flash off Fragas, who did invest into the early Swifties. You know, Santorin is going to be way ahead on the jungle item completion. The Cinderhulk really speeds up your jungle clear there too. So it'll be interesting to track that going forward. Tier done here for Stixday. He is down in lane. He hasn't used his teleport yet, though, so we'll see if they can find any sort of a window to really kind of get an advantage or claw back here in this 2v2 with that teleport.
So far, checking out the lanes, we've got a very, very tight game between these two squads. Two CSD in the top side, two in the jungle, equal in mid, three in bot lane, and two in support. So a very tight one right now. Mountain Drake, the slowest of Drakes to kill. Lowest threat as well, and with Machete has okay damage, and as Stixday shows up, they are going to knock this Drake down. So CLG starting that stack right now. Pulled equal in the early game so far as Santorin, who's losing the Drake, is going to take some of his own camps and try to keep his farm going as red buff is grabbed, and Fragas will head clash over the wall and grab his bottom jungle as well.
I'm excited to also track how Wild Turtle performs because he had really good Ashe game last weekend against EG. He was playing against a pretty heavy dive comp. He never mispositioned. He was hitting constant Ashe ulties and has been, I think, fantastic over the last couple weeks, someone that's kind of a little bit overlooked. You know, we did see FlyQuest sub him out earlier on in the split, and it didn't really work out for them. Turtle was back, and I think playing even better than before he had been subbed out. He talked about, you know, the fact that, you know, he wasn't as motivated. He hadn't been working as hard. Now he is back. He is grinding, and he is looking really solid for this team. So I'm excited to see, can he have another one of those Ashe games where he just can't miss those ults?
We're going to hope so. I mean, FlyQuest fans, I think this is definitely the squad to get behind. They have looked really, really good. I like all the players. They really feel well-rounded. It's a compliment we've given to Golden Guardians. It feels even more so here for FlyQuest, where they've got a lot of really stellar performers. Santorin, I think, should be getting a potential nod as best jungler this split. I know Blabber was such an early start for this one, as he done have fallen off. Santorin has gotten better. Tuesday will be shockwaved in. They're going to find the
arrow.
He can't miss. First blood comes through the power of evil.
Someone check this man's computer because Wild Turtle looks like he is cheating. He's got the aimbot on for the Ashe arrow. What an arrow there coming out of that bottom river. Really nice combination setting it up from Santorin with that pillar, but in goes Fragas. He is looking to snap them in.
Nice play right there. Finds himself one, then two stuns. Santorin's already burned the ulti, but he's going to be healthy enough to walk away from this one. And Herald will reset, so just a bit of damage done back and forth, but not too much else gained. Have that charge right back out and try again for round two. And right now, CLG feel like they have control enough that they can maybe take this Herald. You can see Santorin just taking the chickens right now. Ignar and Solo, though, as they push in the top side, they're going to force the teleport out from Ruin. And the day, that means that they got to be a little cautious, but despite the hot shot, looks like there's going to be no contest. Rift Herald will go to CLG. Now, of course, they are down 1,400 in gold. The First Blood, of course, helps that. But as the lanes are getting behind, Rift Herald will help try to get that back in shape.
See if they can get something effective there, because as you say, lanes are falling behind. You can see Turtle already moving up here. So they're trying to set this up. They drop the pillar. The Ashe arrow gets shot. Shockwave right back to that pillar. Perfect combo. As soon as the pillar is dropped, Turtle shoots his arrow right there. And then Power of Evil, honestly, just a great shockwave. Not enough credit given to him by me in that initial play. Really, really well done to pull him back to that initial point that you had fired the arrow to. That is some impressive team coordination.
Yeah, it was really good. And especially coordination to the fact that, you know, they showed up while Tuesday's flash was still down. They knew they burned it. Everyone pings the summoner. Adding five to the minute tracker is not that hard to do. But showing back up in time, you know, you don't always make that one happen. So good on them to make that one come through. It means you've got a 12 CSD in mid lane as Tuesday had the drop farm. Obviously, the death doesn't help. The kill is nice. And FlyQuest going to feel comfortable with his 1,300 gold lead. We will wait to see when the Herald does indeed drop and, you know, what kind of gold back can give back to CLG. But they've got to come back from a deficit.
they do. And FlyQuest is not a team that often makes a lot of mistakes, that often gives a lot of windows to really claw your way back in with that sort of position. So we'll find out if CLG can really look for some of those windows. I do think a lot of it's going to be on Smoothie to be the guy who is finding ulties to set up for these fights. Ruin and Fragus are going to be having to try to find angles, find flanks where they can really come in from behind and take out Turtle, take out Power of Evil. Because barring that and barring the Bartle, you know, they really don't have a lot of true hard engage. It's very dependent on these more conditional things.
Okay, well, bot pushed in. Easily grabbed by Turtle here. Now fight on the bottom side. Hook's going to come in. They're going to find the jungler. Fragus wants to flash away. Pillar comes in, but he's still safe enough. Phase Rush came through, gave him a ton of move speed. Out he goes. Next Drake spawns in 50 seconds, and a flash of the jungle can make that a little bit more difficult to fight over. Centaurin's already got a Cinder Hulk done, so an item lead in the jungle for sure. Fragus is going to have Hex Flash up in 2 seconds. Can he find a way onto this one?
Doesn't look like it, but nope. Is going to be in the area to try to contest Vision. Centaurin knocking down some of those wards, and given that Ignar is fairly low in health, he's just going to go back to base. Probably grab some pinks here to try to be ready for this dragon. CLG did get the first one. FlyQuest, I'm sure, would love to try to disrupt this. You know, both top laners don't have TP, and I think, honestly, at this point, that's a good thing for FlyQuest. You'd rather keep both the ward and the cannon out of the fight if given the option, and look for that 4v4, where I feel like they're at a pretty heavy advantage.
Then it comes through, because right now you're right, FlyQuest will be getting a lot better around the map. Top lane, splitting farm, that's fine for solo. Protobelt's in, gets rid of some of the minions, keeps the wave under a decent amount of control. And so far, so good. Top lane, splitting farm, equal levels. And now, FlyQuest, look at that, more control around the map. Now, CLG did get the first Drake. That is one thing to their credit. Santorin now with a lot of map control, at least enough that no one's checking him, able to easily solo out the Cloud Drake, grab that one at 12 minutes, and FlyQuest just, you know, sitting here with a small lead, waiting around in the mid game.
Taking that no problem. I do think it's pretty smart for solo, you know, go protobelt. His opponent is going protobelt, and you are playing melee into range, so this does give you the ability to wave clear very effectively. It's a 45-second cooldown, so you have it like every wave and a half. It makes your wave clear very, very effective. They are just going to drop the Herald top. We'll see if solo stays around. I think he actually can just wave clear this out because the turret is full health. He's done a great job of actually keeping that up. So in with the protobelt, clears that out, and he actually just going to drop the ulti because Power of Evil is moving on up here too.
Holds on to Ruin. Big damage here. The cannon's down about 800 HP. A stun and a solo. Here comes the chance at a shockwave. No, it's going to be the dunk backwards instead. Fragus finds a stun. No Ez damage just yet. Shockwave. They're going to juke away from it. Pew, we did it defensively. End of the day, they get two plates. They trade a bunch of ults back and forth. Flash, though, down for Ruin.
Yeah, I'm not sure if Power of Evil was trying to do the defensive ult or if the ball snapped back and was out of range. Either way, it does just result in that trade of cooldowns, and they are going to back it on up. Pretty well defended as far as that Rift Herald goes. They obviously give up the plates and Smoothie here. Oh,
okay.
Flash.
Not a bad ult. Force the flash away. Thumbs up comes out from solo. That's going to be the recall. Actually completed. Meanwhile, Ignar finds himself the kill on a Fragus.
On the hunt here, he has the ult reset and he is behind him. Look at all the FlyQuest. They're moving up. They want to try to dive this. We'll see if solo can actually prevent the recall. Now Smoothie is in trouble. He has his summoners, but he's got no way out,
time
really.
Out. Has to hit it. All right, Smoothie, 1v4. Good luck, bud. I can't believe he didn't survive that fight. What a dive by FlyQuest.
Yeah, Smoothie, you thought he had it for sure, you know?
I really did.
Yeah, what an outplay. Either way, Smoothie going down. They're going to get a lot of tower damage back here as the plates did fall. Now, let's watch this one more time. And it's that ward over by the Gromp. Ignar spots him, and because it is actually this Infernal Rift, he doesn't have to walk over that other ward. He can just sneak right past, has full vision of him the whole time. Easy way in there. Ease forward with the ignite. Gets the short Q for the damage in the XU range. Nicely played. And then up back up on this top side. Kennen had actually gone back to base with very, very low, and Smoothie just has no chance here. It's the 4v1. They've completely surrounded him. He knows he's going to die. There's really no outplaying it. Tuesday's moving up, but there was never any chance for him to live long enough to actually do anything there.
Yeah, he got a sight on completions. Like, I guess I'll drop a ward. Like, in case the turret dies, here's some vision. Like,
so
I respect
that. You
can
see your corpse. I like
it. It's, like, literally free. Okay, you know, it's fine. You did what you could. That's a stun, though. That's
Ooh.
A big play. That's a dunk backwards. That has got to be a kill. PoE should not live this, and he will not. assists from almost everybody there. Finally a kill on the board. CLG gets something done.
Nicely done. They have the ward over the wall there, and Frag is saying, anything you could do, I could do better. Hex flash over the wall gets the kill. Pyro People is going for a Lich Bane here, which I've got a question. I was more behind the Nashers thinking, because he used to always go for the Nashers Roa style,
right.
You know. I don't know. Maybe this will work out. It is really great in Siege, and if you're going to play side lane, that could be fantastic, but not convinced by the Lich Bane. We'll see how many autos he can get out. Is Turtle going to be wide on the arrow there? TP's coming through. Will be the smite.
Well, Yu Stun comes in. Centaurin flashes over to fight for the Drake. It's going to go through. Nicely done. Stixxay grabs it, and now Centaurin has killed Fragus, though. So out goes CLG, trying to walk away. They have grabbed the Scuttle or the Herald in time, but it's two kills picked up. Fragus dived for it. Stixxay gets chased down the drop as well.
Stixxay brought into the no fun zone there by Solo. Oh. As he gets ulted up, no kiting that for Ezreal, and they are just on the push. So Hashin going to be getting some damage down here. Power of Evil will have additional power on that seed, as I was saying. Nice shockwave too. But your burst is going to be lower when you go this style of build versus, you know, just going double spell pen, right? Because he's rushing towards this instead of grabbing the sword fruits, instead of grabbing the Oblivion Orb. So there is a price to be paid, but your damage theoretically can be quite high even in team fights as long as you're weaving in the autos with your spells.
Yeah.
It's just not always realistic to get it out, and that's kind of why I feel like we saw Power of Evil move away from this previous popular tech, which was the Roa Nashers.
Right.
But maybe the thought process here is it's like, well, you don't need as many autos to get as much out of it. You just need to do an auto every once in a while.
Yeah, I'm wondering if he's buying it for the stat profile. It's 10 more CDR and some move speed, which are like both things you care about on Orianna a fair bit, right? It's what you were really missing with the Roa build.
Why not Spellbinders, right? If you want move speed.
Because you want 10 CDR. Like, I'm not saying it's like definitely the best build, but I'm like, okay, if you really want those stats, which Bane does it? I don't know. Like, I really don't know. I'm not sold either. I'm just saying, like, hey, what are the other reasons you might do this? And stat profile's not bad.
No, it's definitely not bad. Gives you some mana. I mean, it's obviously fine. It's not a terrible item by any means. But it's just interesting. And he has his own way of doing things. He's kind of moving
on
that, though. Oh, the arrow.
That is a stun. That is a shockwave. And that is a dead smoothie. He flashes, so there's no reset. But the re-engage could be good. Kennen helps him find one, and they find two. And now Santorin's on the run. Gets chopped down a little bit. Solo's still fighting out with Ruin, but can't get that much done. Tuesday wants to go forward. Finds one stun. Has to kite Solo. He's going to get followed. He's going to get killed. It'll be traded back. Still a 3-for-2 in favor of CLG.
Great ultimate there from Ruin. Despite the fact that Solo did use his ultimate onto the cannon, it was too little too late. Most of the damage had already been done there by Ruin. He just shredded through them, and Ignar did not get the reset. As you said, Smoothie flashed out, so they will win the fight. They will grab the dragon. Well done here by CLG, battling back from a pretty tough position. They're even going to grab that mid lane turret and get a second charge, so CLG pretty much back in this, but they have spotted Ruin, who has no ulti and potentially could just get chased down.
1v2, Halo Blades is so much damage, by the way. Auto, auto, auto. He's chunked pretty low. Ezreal ult not quite going to land. A flash for Ruin, but he's slowed. He is dead for this one. The flash accomplished nothing, and Ruin will not have that for the next Drake fight.
Yeah, going to be out of there. And as you say, it is that Halo Blades pike. Pretty standard stuff. From that, it is great anytime you can get those auto attacks out. And here this is one more time. The ulti comes across. The shockwave follow-up was great. They had them pillared in. But the unstoppable there from Fragus, it was actually really well timed. He actually got the ulti because Trundle got too close. So gave him a target, which allows him to have unstoppable with his ultimate to dunk out of the shockwave and clap them together. So Fragus was really good on that. A bit of a mistake from Santorin, albeit an understandable one. And then Solo, not able to get the ulti onto Ruin right away because he was stunned up. And Ruin got a fantastic ultimate across that team and allowed CLG to win out there.
All right, well, Merlinomicon comes through, which is going to help when you have Santorin's ulti on, but otherwise not a ton of healing on the FlyQuest side. Maybe it could have been skipped, but regardless, I can see it. Summon a heal can sometimes be valuable as well. It's one of the more debatable ones, but I don't hate it here in this game. And Hurricane comes through for Wild Turtle on the Ash, and we move towards what I think is correct actually here for Stixxay, going Trinity Force, as he really does not need armor very much in this game. He needs raw health to survive the Pyke ult and to help get away from all the magic damage that Power of Evil and Solo are doing.
Yep, and if you are kind of caught in that 1v1 against the Ward, you know, Triforce is likely going to be helping you out there. A lot more attack speed, you know, higher raw DPS to put out against that front line. We'll see how effective it can be. You know, the only argument is really if you think you're just going to kind of get burst down by the Pyke, I guess, but not too likely to happen, and Ignar will be able to scoot out of there.
He's going to be okay. Yeah. I think the Glacial Slow is the other side. Like, I don't think that helps you enough against Mordekaiser, even if he does ult you. I think you ultimately just want the better stat profile. So, we'll wait to see the Dalton come through. 6A is going to be the primary physical damage on the team, of course, as Ruin and Tuesday are doing all the magic damage. Teamfight Engage certainly is here. We'll see how it can play out over time. CLG still suffering a 3,500 gold deficit as FlyQuest, they have been bleeding the occasional Drake, the occasional teamfight. Yes, they are up in gold, but they are not completely in control of this game. This time around, though, Ash Arrow is going to land on a smoothie. No easy follow through, but it does mean the turret will fall.
And I like the threat of the flank here from Ignar. I do think that a lot of the things that make him actually so good at Rakan are really showing through as an asset on Pyke. Right? He's constantly in a position where he's sneaking around to the side. He's utilizing the mobility of this champion. You know, you have the E, you have your W to kind of go through that camouflage to really escape if the team tries to turn on you. Just very similar to what Rakan has, right? So you can always put yourself in this position where you're at a very risky spot, and if they ignore you, they are going to get blasted by you. So he's always threatening the flanks. He's threatening to come over the wall. He's putting himself in this spot where it says, you cannot ignore me. You must deal with the Pyke. You must deal with the Rakan, and drawing so much additional threat.
Meanwhile, a little bit of gold left on the table. The top lane was pushed in, but Tuesday did not stick around for local gold. There was no threat onto him. There were three or four shown in mid lane. He probably could have gone for three autos, then recalled. It's a minor thing, but you know, it's always nice to get your power spikes on in time. I mean, realistically, it's two full items under Power of Evil, and really Illudens and components here for Tuesday, so a lot of mid-item difference here. CLG still weathering a very, very rough start to this one. Now, 22 minutes in, catching farm as best they can, hoping for that next big team fight play.
It definitely is a bit concerning that they're down over 4,000 gold when they just won that last team fight and, you know, got kills, got a tower, you know, got all these things kind of working for them from that. The only thing really going in their favor right now feels like the dragons, so we'll see if they can continue to stack that up. They are going to need to continue to have good Kennen ults, though, to win out there, and FlyQuest has shown in the past that they're really good at dealing with that, so they need to maintain flank wards for Ruin, try to set him up to have these really good ultimates, and Shockwave will miss. Nice proto belt from Ruin to just scoot out of there.
Alrighty. Well, once again, waiting for the next play. 30 seconds on the Infernal Drake to spawn. CLG have gotten two of these Drakes so far. They got the first and the third. We'll see if they can make this stack happen. Would be nice to see some more stats on them. It feels like their team fights are very explosive, very bursty. Infernal kind of makes sense for them if they can make it happen. It would actually help key into their win conditions. Certainly they have engaged tools, right? Bard, Fragus has clearly been willing to go in and risk his life for it. With the Swifties, that obviously helps, and Ruin has been able to make the flank place happen, has spellbooked over to Exhaust for a second Summoner. As we know, his flash will not be up until 30 seconds after the Drake spawns. So maybe he can burn the Exhaust to get them ready, or they can maybe wait the 30 seconds out for that flash to be back, and they can make the flank plays look a little bit better. Pushing in now for the River, 6A goes for the ward, gets that one. Ignar spotted out, has to burn the passive cooldown as technically the ward saw him.
And this would be such a big win for CLG and for their Academy players in
specific. Arrow down.
As they do dodge that arrow.
Baited it. There is the flash in to pull in two. Finds the stun. Ez over the top. Pulled away to not get any more. Fragus going to kite away. Solo now finds Tuesday in the 1v1. And this is a very easy fight for the Mordekaiser. A flash for Tuesday. But he's going to be on top of Ignar, who times the ult and claims the kill. The re-engage is not going to be enough. They all get away from Ruin. It's going to be nothing on the board at all for CLG. Two kills picked up already. Maybe looking at a third as Smoothie tries to run away. The Drake already picked up. The chase is coming through. Finally slowed down again. The flash not going to get the pull, but Smoothie still being slowed, still going to be cut down. Power of Evil claims that kill, and Fragments can only run away. They find a single kill, but it will be a 4-for-1 plus the Drake for FlyQuest.
Make it plus the Baron. They're going straight for it. They know with Frag is dead, they have got this. Yes, Ruin's alive, but he doesn't even have his ultimate. He actually spent it a one-man ulti trying to kill off Ignar, which he wasn't even able to do. And now FlyQuest feels like are going to have everything they need to win this game. This gold lead was already very big. It's going to be enormous. CLG are TPing over to the Dragon. They're going to try to get that for themselves and put themselves at soul point, maybe a small win condition that they could have there, but I'm not even sure that they can do it because Solo has TP and this dragon is not going down quickly. They're now spotted by Turtle, so FlyQuest should be able to get here in time to contest. Thumbs up from Solo as he says, thanks for the leash.
Yep, and that's going to be Drake number two. Okay. It is eventually plus the Drake. I forgot that it didn't die during that fight. They let it stay alive. They got it now. End of the day, both neutrals and again, plus three kills in that team fight.
Yep, so here's this fight one more time. And Ruin had to get out of there as he was spotted by the pink ward. The arrow did miss from Turtle. Fragas goes deep here, but who's really supposed to follow up? You know, Ruin doesn't have Flash. He gets Shockwave back, which was a great Shockwave there from Power of Evil. And Power of Evil is just zoning people out. Notice how he kept that ball in that little zone control spot, you know, on the ramp so they can't actually walk up. We see that Ignar, as Tuesday came out of that ultimate, Solo had him so low, and then Ignar could just land the ulti, finish him off with the execute, gets that kill for them there, and the chase down just continues over and over. Chilling Smite comes through the pillar to set up another ulti there from Ignar as they grab the next couple kills. And as soon as Fragas went down, you knew it was going to be the Baron. FlyQuest now so far ahead. Now, nearly 8,000 gold is the lead. Solo's going to be down here knocking down this turret as well, no problem.
Yeah, this will be 8K for sure, as this one's going to drop. It's already there. Turret's going to make it 8.5. Solo taking a couple turret shots. He's fine. Gold in his pockets. Mid lane under fire. Santorin feels comfortable, puts down the pillar, zones out the squad, and CLG can only sit inside their base and wait. Death Can't say I've been disappointed with Fragas, but CLG's still not on the same level as these teams, it feels.
No, I mean, I think both Fragas and Tuesday have been fine, but the game does not look close. You know, FlyQuest is playing very, very well. Their team play is so much better. How they're actually, you know, layering their ultimates, you know, utilizing their crowd control is far superior. Now the Shockwave catches Fragas.
Big Shockwave, big big execute. Ignar's on the board yet again. The CC chain keeps coming in, and they're ready to keep going for this one. 5v4, no jungler, no good engage tools. Back up the wall goes Ignar looking for some poke, and they will wait for the next wave.
They Shockwave him to the wall, pull him over the wall with the hook from there with Ignar, and you said it, the crowd control chains have just been so good. You know, going even back to that initial kill on Tuesday, way back, where they set up the Ash Arrow, you know, with the Trundle Pillar, Shockwave him back onto the pillar, land that Ash ulti. You know, they have been pulling off these chains so incredibly well. That is very much intentional, you know, what they are doing. Because it's so easy to just like Shockwave someone out of a hook. Instead, they are consistently doing it into the crowd control, which speaks to, you know, high level communication and coordination that is being consistently pulled off here by FlyQuest.
Pull them ahead now on the Orianna as well as the Banshee's Veil comes through for Tuesday a little while ago. Sorry, PoE has already finished his death cap. There's the IE, third item done on a wild turtle. Not only is it gold, obviously ahead for FlyQuest. It's on enough of the right people that they're ahead in items, and they will out-carry their opponents. Edge of Night comes through, so Ignar's got two lethality items, and he's like impossibly hard to kill. This is just FlyQuest getting ready to close this game out. Baron buff times out. They've got their 10,000 gold lead. They're not getting Soul anytime soon, but they can close out this game before too long.
And when you're this far behind, you don't actually get to go towards the luxury items, so there's no QSS on anyone. So Solo can ult anyone he wants. And even if it's a losing fight, he has a Zonius. You can ult someone just sitting here Zonius if you want to take them out of the fight. So, you know, Solo likely will win any 1v1 he sets himself up for. No one can actually get out of that death realm because they don't have the money to go towards the QSS. When you're 10,000 gold behind, you need the damage. You just need to have the opportunity to maybe get a kill if you can get that correct pick. So I think it is correct to not be going for it, but it just means bad goes to worse as Solo kind of has his pick of the litter.
Yep, Needlessly Large Rod comes through for Ruin, hoping in about 2,300 gold he can finish death cap. Now that would be nice to see, but it seems so terribly unlikely. I expect FlyQuest to move towards a bit of MR over time. Obviously, Merc Dread's in there for Power of Evil, but nothing yet on Turtle. Top being attacked, but wave cleared pretty easily as there's no Baron buff left. Doesn't matter though, the turret is still frail and pretty grabbed by FlyQuest, growing the lead to 11,500.
Yep, the luxury items can come through on the other side too. As we see the stopwatch picked up here by Power of Evil, he bought that plus the Blasting Wand on his last way back, has his flash available, so very unlikely to get picked off. As you said, Turtle doesn't really have any defensive itemization, but this is the same thing he did against EG, and I've got to give him credit. You know, I won't criticize it or question it because he has been positioning so well. This is, you know, two Ash games in a row that he potentially is deathless. The one before that, he only had one death. The one before that, he only had one death. Like, he just doesn't seem to die on Ash. So he really is positioning himself effectively. And if you can get away with it, you know, you're going to do more damage with this style of build. So until he's punished for it, you know, it seems like it is correct, at least the way he's playing.
Yeah, doing a great job right here. So controller goes down to the pit. They are ready to get Drake number three here on FlyQuest's side. They can get a 35-minute Ocean Soul if it really needs to happen. But honestly, I expect it to be a little bit sooner than that. We'll see, though. Depends how well CLG can defend. They pull it out of the pit, give themselves a bit more reach, make Fargus have to overextend a bit farther to go for the steal. And realistically, that is not going to be the play. There was no cutoff whatsoever. Smite to make sure that nothing goes over the wall, no true shot barrage or, you know, Syndra QE or something kind of silly like that. Just guarantee it, no big deal. Baron's in 15, and Centurion's going to have Smite.
Ooh, Fragus is probably dead here. Ignar's behind him.
Okay, flash to get away, but he burns his Smite versus Flash. He's out of summoners right now. Second Smite is going to be up, but the jungler chunked to half, and on the other side of the map, Baron is a very easy target.
It's about to spawn, so they're going to go straight for it. They already have that mid lane inhibitor down. At the very least, they could try to force out, you know, TP from someone like Ruin, who's actually showing on that bottom side. Kind of surprised that FlyQuest isn't just straight up starting it, but maybe want to go back and get some more vision first. You can see that there are no wards on Ignar, so maybe want to make fully certain that the area is covered. And there is that one pesky ward in the pixel brush, so.
Right. Well, and it's still no defense for Turtle. Going for another Zeal, probably Phantom Dancer will be eventually a defensive item. It is a lot of health functionally with that shield, but. You know, saying screw it, we're not getting MR. It is double Void Staff, to be fair, from the big mages, so that does devalue things like Hexdrinker a little bit, pushes you towards Phantom Dancer a little bit extra. And now, is this the fight? Is this the play that CLG hope they can find? Santorin on the front line, he's tanky, though, and 6A forced to QSS and jump over the wall as the arrow was going to land. And now the dunk to the backside, decent damage, but it's not going to be enough for Fragus. There comes Kennen over the top, it's decent damage, and they do find a single kill, but it'll be more than just that. Shotgun's going to miss, but solo very, very low. Can't get killed. He's going to wait for the W to be back active again. Gets the shield. Going to be just absolutely fine. Team fight again. Won by FlyQuest. Only 2-1, though. It could have been more of a blowout. CLG still fighting a bit close.
It was very close, I think, thanks largely in part to Ruin's great ultimate. They have been very reliant on that. You know, kind of the only good team fights they've had are the ones where Kennen gets a great ult, that first one that they won by the dragon. Now here, getting a really good ult, keeping them close despite a massive gold lead. The FlyQuest are the much healthier team right now. They are starting this up. Solo TP's back, Power of Evil TP's back, and this should be theirs. Fragus is nowhere close, just respawning in base, and CLG will see it, but too little too late.
Yeah, not going to happen there. They look at the Baron, they see it die. The rest of the squad, though, already there. Solo TP'd back in, make sure he was there. PoE the same, no one for contest. Baron goes to FlyQuest.
Good attempt here, though, from CLG. You know, they're still fighting, looking for a pick. As 6A is able to QSS shift over the wall there. Fragus goes in, but does get knocked down very, very quickly. But this is the turnaround for Ruin. He comes in from the side, gets a really nice ultimate out, but then solo on point, landing his own ultimate on the Kennen to stop the continuation of that damage. You know, you talked about that interaction. It has been key for FlyQuest to try to deny Kennen from really wiping through that rest of the team.
Yeah, it looked like right there it was a attempted stopwatch burn by Ruin to get untargetable before the ult could land, but now a fight into the bottom side as he tries to kite away. Fragus in danger, deals big damage to Ignar, but now here's the increased danger. Shotgun's going to land, Centaurin just dives in to be the target of that one, but will be stunned, will be slowed, will have to walk away. No deaths, but still a 13,000 gold with a Baron buff on for 2 minutes. CLG fighting from a deficit. Kennen ult is going to be back up, but his flash is down.
Good disengage there from CLG as it looked like they may have been caught out. Turtle pushing up mid lane though. He does have his ultimate available, so you always have to be careful about that. And this is double open inhibitors here. So Power of Evil, it's only going to take an auto or two, honestly, with the Lich Bane plus the Death Cap. Like, that is just so much damage coming through. Three or four autos will knock down that one, and now Turtle has the mid lane prepped. They can continue to close out this game. CLG getting crushed in this one. Haven't really been able to find much purchase.
Not quite there. Sad to see for CLG. You could see the glimmers of what it could have been, right? If this game were closer by 5,000 or 6,000 gold, you know, only half the lead that FlyQuest has, those teamfights could have gone the rest of the way over and CLG maybe turns the corner. But honestly, at a certain point, FlyQuest was hitting them with their gold lead, saying, well, you turned to half, but even at half health, you still do more damage than you. And, you know, we'll survive the fight for the rest of it. And that's just been the case right here. 13,000 ahead. FlyQuest have knocked down middle and bottom inhibitor. Smoothie, one hit from dead. Not quite going all the way down, so it does mean he can run back to base. Shockwave now, of course, on cooldown means that they can clear top end without too much scare. And now a TP spent looking for a possible play. Okay, Ruin, can you do it? Nice pillar means no, you cannot. That is so clutch, though, because without that pillar, that is probably a three-man shockwave and the chance of a teamfight win. But now solo flashes into solo Ruin. Ulti traded back and forth, and it's not even close. This fight is not to be had. grab no problem at all. And now the dunk on the backside, look for PoE, but traded instead as Fragus dies, as there is already the ults coming through for Pike. Gets the reset though, looking for more. That's going to be the kill, knocked down, one for Tuesday. But the rest of the team is still running for their lives. 6A very, very low. One more hit would kill him. A perfect stopwatch. Turtle takes like no damage, but still answered back all the same as the Orianna shield dropped off. It is a kill on the board, two to be fair, but still a team fight won by FlyQuest.
They are very low though. 6A almost has his ultimate, so this is actually possible to get an ultimate snipe here. We'll see if he can find anyone on the way out. Doesn't look like he's even going to go for it, though, as super minions coming in from all sides. FlyQuest running straight over towards this dragon. Here it is one more time. Great pillar. And honestly, it was more about the wards. FlyQuest had a lot of wards over in that area, so they were easily able to spot Ruin coming in from the side. Then solo, protobelt, flash, ulti catches Ruin here and going to be able to knock him down very comfortably. They decide to get aggressive. Frag is turning around here, looking to see if he can set something up. Power Grill was so low, but not able to get quite enough to take him down. Then Ignar on the E-Flash, trying to stun them both up, but a nice little side step from Stixxay. Him and Tuesday are able to get over to the side, and then Turtle getting very aggressive. Uses his stopwatch, was well-timed, but he just gets popped by Tuesday, his first death of the game. And honestly, first time he got super aggressive is his first death there.
Well, we get the Fenrir Answer done. That is an extra shield on top. We'll help him survive next time around. And a Null Magic Mantle gets him slightly closer there. 3.5 items on Tuesday. Death Cap done for Ruin, level 18, and he has Flash and Ghost. If there is a time that CLG finds a miracle play, it is through that, because otherwise this game is over. FlyQuest have Infernal Soul, and they got the chance at a big play. A stun across the map finds Smoothie, and that man is surrounded. You are always dead here. Give it to Ignar. Extra money over the top. Thanks very much.
Grab another kill there with the dunk, as you said. You get that kill with the LT, you both get gold, so share the wealth around here. FlyQuest, another great arrow from Turtle as they had spotted him over there, and they surround him, they kill him off, three inhibitors are down, the Nexus turrets are low, it is a 5v4, enormous gold lead, almost 15,000 plus the Infernal Soul. Nothing CLG can do here.
Well, they're going to try in the 4v5. Fragus is the front line, looks to find something there, but Ruin has to wait around for maybe a Mordekaiser ulti. Does nothing so far. The champions are already dead. They're missing two now. And at what point can they even re-engage? At some point, they might try to fight, but not in time. They look for the kills on the backside. They will take that fight first. Of course, he is pulled in with Mordekaiser and just does not damage Power of Evil. An easy kill for the Mord. Solo grabs that one. They're ready to close this game out. It is still a 5v3 to siege it. Shockwave going to be dodged. Pull's not going to land either, but there's still minions inside the base. They are safe to push in. There's a pillar for good measure, a stun on top of the base as well. Ignar finds another kill, and FlyQuest will claim their 11th win of the split.
Dominating game there from FlyQuest. Really well done. Start to finish, it felt like they were in control. They had better laning, better coordination, better team fighting. You know, really across the board, this is a pretty strong showing from them, especially considering that they went for a pretty heavily scaling comp, especially on the top side. And I've got to give credit to Solo, 7-1-7 on the Mordekaiser, really did largely neutralize Ruin's Kennen with his ultimates, was very good with that. I wasn't as convinced in champs like by the pick, but I think he made it work incredibly well. And, just a solid game from them overall.
Yeah, and it's hard to pick out an individual outperformer here on the FlyQuest side because so much of it was coordination. You talked about how well they did the CC stacking, right? The pillar comes in into the hook, into the arrow, into the shockwave, and everyone was always there. Santorin did go deathless, was a good frontline there for the squad, but regardless, a good showing all around by FlyQuest. They are a game behind second and third place right now. There's a chance they can steal that playoff bye. We'll see if it can happen based on how the games go, but we are going to head to a break. Now we're going to hear from Santorin afterwards in the Verizon postgame interview. So don't go anywhere.
Verizon knows how to build unlimited right. You start with America's most awarded network, the one with unbeatable reliability 13 times in a row.
This network is one less thing I have to worry about.
Then you give people more plans to mix and match, so you only pay for what you need.
Verizon Unlimited plan is so reasonable, they could stay on for the rest of their lives.
You include the best in entertainment, and you offer it all starting at $35, because everyone deserves the best. This is Unlimited Built Right, only on Verizon.
Welcome back, everyone, to the LCS here with another Verizon post-game interview alongside your jungler, Santorin, after that victory. First things first, you went into this game against the CLG that looked different than other times. You spent some time mid as usual, but it seemed a bit more. What was your game plan going into this particular game?
Well, it's always weird when they randomly just switch in new players. Honestly, we weren't really too sure what to expect out of like Fragus and Tuesday. I mean, obviously, like they must have been doing like pretty well in scrims or something. If they choose to like week nine, it's like you're fine for playoffs, and they have faith in these players. So like, we're obviously not like underestimating them, but we definitely felt confident like that we'd beat them.
Yeah, and that confidence carried through a strong performance from FlyQuest from beginning to end. And one thing that I wanted to get your opinion on is the fact that FlyQuest has built this consistency, right, that we've talked about before, this definitive play style. And when it comes to these kind of final weeks, right, that you have before going into playoffs, do you think it's more important to experiment, get those last questions answered, or continuing trying to refine the style that has been working for you all this time?
Honestly, I think it's like getting pretty late into the season, so I definitely want to like refine the style we have. But obviously, like that doesn't mean we shouldn't pick up new champions. Like obviously, we're not just this one-dimensional team that only plays this specific way. We can definitely play other champions, but this is just like our bread and butter, and especially against the lower tier teams. I mean, I don't know why they give it to us, but we'll take it every time.
Yeah, the bread and butter that we like to see from FlyQuest. And one thing that has been key to that is your performance. And in times past, when Cloud9 was utterly dominating, it seemed like Blabber was the one always overtaking the jungler conversation. But now your name has been spewing up more and more when it comes to speaking about this position. How do you feel that you stand when it comes to the jungler conversation currently within the LCS?
I mean, I think I've been playing really, really well this split. Obviously, it depends what you value in the player. I've been playing a lot of the tanks, the early game like setups. I'm not really like the carry jungler, you know, like I carry through like the way I play the game, how I help my team and how I set them up. I definitely think I've been doing really, really well. And honestly, I think I should definitely be in the top. But that doesn't like disregard that obviously like Blabber is still really, really good and stuff like that.
When you speak about the specific jungler role that you play, when it comes to potentially playing a more, I guess, carry type jungler, is that something that you see yourself interested in doing? Or is it just something because you're always playing around the solo laners specifically that isn't really up the alley here?
Oh, hell yeah. I mean, I am a carry jungler by heart. I hate playing tanks. I actually hate playing tanks. But I just feel like it works really, really well for our team. That doesn't mean we don't play carry junglers. We definitely do. But I mean, it's just like, if they keep giving it to us, we might as well just take it and like take the wins we can get.
And when you're trying to think about taking those wins that you can get, and when we're looking at the playoffs, there's a lot of teams that are getting locked and you're looking to make a deep run as the goals have been stated by you and your teammates. Are there any teams in particular that you're looking to avoid as long as possible, or ones that you are already eager to try and face off against?
Honestly, I still feel like Cloud9 is probably our best opponent, like, sorry, the hardest opponent for us. I just feel like they're really, really aggressive early game. And I feel like that's just like the way we play as a team. Cloud9 is the one that comes to my mind where I'm like kind of afraid, even though they've been playing like not so great. I still feel like if they get back on track, they can be a really strong team. But I don't personally feel that afraid of like TSM or TL or something like that.
But before you get to that point, you do have one more match to go, and it's against Immortals, who, despite the loss, Xsmithy had a strong performance on Olaf, a different pick than we usually see from him. How do you think you're going to fare in this particular jungle matchup that you have tomorrow?
I think it's going to be interesting. I've been playing a lot of tanks. Xsmithy's always been known for tanks. Like, he's always been like the guy that sets up his team. So I want to like take him on and like show I'm the better tank player now.
Try and just own that position, right? Well, thanks for coming in and owning some time on this interview, Santorin. Always a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.
All right, everyone. That was our last game of the day, which means we have one last thing to do, and that's send it over to the State Farm analyst desk to wrap things out for us.
Thank you very much, the Tigress. FlyQuest with the victory over CLG in that one. You know, expected result, I would say. But it still didn't necessarily in some ways come as easy as you would expect, considering that CLG was playing two of their academy players on the roster in this final week of play.
It was a pretty good debut, I think, more from Tuesday than from Fragus in the LCS. So they're trying things out, and the Syndra wasn't too bad. He just got punished so hard by the roams from FlyQuest, never really caught a break.
Yeah, you called out the roaming. That's Ignar, Mark.
Yep, he was our player to watch heading into the day for FlyQuest, and he has been phenomenal. And a pick like Pyke is exactly what you want to see out of him, to be able to get out and affect side lanes. Able to go in initially, just burn flash. He's going to re-peak gank it again. And it's always him and Trundle working well together. It's great to see Santorin and him. The pillar sets up this play. It's just
arrow to boot.
Yeah,
love it.
I mean, that's feel bad for Tuesday. I mean, that's a tough debut.
Welcome to the LCS,
that's,
baby.
Yeah, that's a welcome to the
hey,
LCS.
Hey, Fragus, you want to get in here too? Let me show you what's up too. Yeah.
Ignar was the one man welcoming party. I love
baptism
it.
By fire by Ignar. Yeah.
Oh, lordy lord.
And we also got to see PoE's Lichbane Orianna.
Might have
actually been
it,
the
please.
First and only time we get to see it in the LCS for different reasons there. But
he got one auto attack in that fight, and he's going to get one more in Ezreal right
yeah,
here.
Yeah, right here. It's going to be the whip that
so,
kills him.
Boom.
Well, bam! That's a, that's a Lichbane
that
proc right there.
I think
there.
The Q hit first, but woo! Realistically, this is going to spell doom for FlyQuest if they go into playoffs with like better teams and then he's like trolling builds, because this is just item loss. I hope PoE is only doing this because like the game was secure. They felt very confident in the win, and this is not going to be a habit he goes back to.
Maybe he has a secret deal with Boris too. Like, what's the weirdest thing you can win with, and like get away with still believably?
Art and
mini games within the games.
Oh,
I'm sure the coaching staff was threw out a list of bounties before the game started. Build a Lichbane, still win, you get kudos. No, FlyQuest, they're picking up the win here to move to 11-6. It was interesting in that interview to hear Santorin kind of talk about looking at Cloud9 as still the team, even in the midst of them not playing so well recently, that they look at as kind of the aspirational team of how to navigate team fights and how well coordinated they generally can be when they come away with those dominant victories.
No one has been as scary as Cloud9 has been at their peak in the entirety of the year. So to see Cloud9 as still capable of delivering those kinds of performances is how FlyQuest comes to the conclusions. Like, hey, we should actually watch out for this team more than anybody else. Because, yeah, they might be slumping, but if they just turn it on for playoffs and suddenly are back to the form that they had before, they are far and away the top dogs in the playoff bracket.
This is what makes it so exciting, though, is that you don't know if that's going to happen. TL, despite looking a little shaky today, they still won the game. They've been winning games. They grind people out, which is a tough thing to do in a best of five, where you have to get three of those wins over them. That's what makes, I think, Team Liquid scary. TSM has these vast champion pools that they're busting out. FlyQuest is starting to look better, roaming all over the map. And even Golden Guardians, they did go 0-2 this week, but they were on a really hot streak as well prior to that.
Yeah, more than anything, the important thing to come away from today with is the standings. We're getting a closer and closer look at a solidified playoff picture. Team Liquid up there has officially locked first place, two wins ahead of Cloud9. And so that is all done and dusted. TSM Cloud9, though, they remain tied for second. And so if both win out in their games tomorrow, it will force that head-to-head tiebreaker between the two for the second and final playoff bye. We've got FlyQuest, who's been in steady fourth place, while the lower end of our bracket remains quite tumultuous. Now, again, I'll remind everyone, you see 1-7 there. Those seven teams are locked into the playoff picture. In fact, our 6-1 are locked from the perspective of knowing that they are for sure in the upper bracket and have double elim secured. So then it's just between CLG, Dignitas, and Immortals to lock up that eighth and final spot in the playoffs and a lower bracket.
That's where it gets hyphy dash, because I don't think CLG is going to be Cloud9 tomorrow, which means they stay at 5, they get a tiebreaker with Dig, and it's going to get even more thrilling if IMT is actually able to take down Immortals FlyQuest tomorrow.
Boom.
Giving us three teams at 5-13.
Crumbs gave you the formula. Let me give you the schedule so you can see all of those games we got coming at you. A whole bunch of bangers, particularly our TSM versus Team Liquid matchup. But that comes before our regular season games finish out with that FlyQuest versus Immortals matchup that you're talking about, Crumbs, where if Immortals can manage to get the upset complete, they would also join Dignitas at 5-13, and assuming that dropped game by CLG to Cloud9, we would have a three-way tie for the final spot in playoffs. But I think perhaps more importantly is the conversation around TSM versus TL tomorrow, our tied for second against first. Mark, talk to me about this. That could be the decider to force a second place by tiebreaker.
potentially forces a second place tiebreaker for TSM. It potentially gives you a lot of momentum heading into the playoffs, and it also might settle the MVP discussion. I mean, Core JJ had a fantastic game on Thresh. Bjergsen had a great game on LeBlanc, and they've been going back and forth, you know, trading who's looking better in the back half of this split. And I think it's super close. I think a lot of people will be swayed by this head-to-head matchup, and if any of them has a bad game or has a fantastic game.
I'm itching now to know what the answers and the results are going to be. Anybody want to give me an idea of where they're leaning?
Yeah, what happens if Cloud9 has a great game? I mean, somebody like Blabber just absolutely styles on the position, because I think the Grace could still be up for grabs, because if Bjergsen or Corey have just an okay game and C9 just suddenly show up, we can't forget all of the work that they've done at the beginning of the season.
He shows up against CLG.
And and especially after yesterday's performance, too. It's like,
yeah,
too little, too late is the phrase, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, is that where you land, Prowly? I mean, because we always have this battle in week nine around, like, recency, right? That recency bias of the surge towards playoffs versus something like Cloud9 with the 9-0 start and how good Blabber was. But do you feel like when the pressure's on that more weight should be given to the back half of the split in some sense?
No, I think it should be pretty equal. I mean, I do think, yeah, the beginning, maybe some people are going to see it lighter because it's like, you know, the teams are still gelling. We don't know the meta yet, so the games are a bit more of a toss-up. But I think the longevity of performance over the split is going to be the most, like, important one. And, yeah, Cloud9 just had such a problem in the back half. I think it's going to be a little bit harder for them to kind of sneak into the MVP discussion now.
All right, well, four more games stand between us and the conclusion of the regular split. That is, of course, before any possible tiebreakers. But don't you worry, tomorrow we will be on top of that for you. So if you stay tuned here to the analyst desk, we will walk you through every step of the way when it comes down to those tiebreakers. But that's going to do it for us here on this LCS Saturday. Now, on behalf of myself, the casters, and the entire remote broadcast crew, thank you for watching, and we'll see you later for more LCS. Good night.
Dead end.